are back. Now, we just had the Bible girl on the show, a new girl on the scene, but it's time for the gates of hell to open up and some legends to take the stage. Please welcome the Boulay Brothers. Yeah. From Hades.
Yes.
Adam, please give them some posing music. Yes, give it to them.
What camera are we looking at?
Pose, yes. Give it to them from hell, darling. Wonderful. Thank you, guys. Hey, Quinn.
Of course, hey, Quinn.
So exciting to have you guys on the show.
Thank you. We're really happy to be here.
Looking sickening. Lady Red, you know these hoes.
Baby, that's my family.
We love Lady Red so much. She's so much fun every time she comes to the club.
Yeah, you guys are killing it. I mean, you guys have been killing it for years, but right now you're having a big moment in LA nightlife.
Yes.
Queen Kong, Beardo Weirdo, Dragula, which is all around the country.
Yes.
I mean, you guys are not only just doing stuff in LA, but you're doing stuff in San Francisco, New York.
Right.
You guys are doing it.
Yeah. Yes.
But let's clear something up. Y'all ain't brothers.
Well, no, we're not.
Y'all are special friends.
Yeah. Yes.
I like to say brother fuckers, sister fuckers, lesbians from another dimension.
Like, yes. I was like, Lady Red, are the Boulay Brothers brothers?
I love that comment, though, because people will come up to us in the club, too, like, you and your brother are so, you guys are so amazing. And then I make sure the next time we're on stage together, we're like, okay, let's get to it. And we're like,
yes.
The live tongue lashing, and that little girl in the audience is like,
terrified.
Nothing wrong with a brother kissing another
brother. Well, we don't think so either.
Not at all.
We encourage everyone to try it.
You guys were actually introduced by a friend at a classic New York spot, La Nouvelle Justine, the S&M restaurant, right?
Yes.
That is quite an appropriate place for the two of y'all dark motherfuckers to have met.
Yeah,
so too.
You couldn't have wrote that out yourself. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was kind of a twist of events. But basically since then, which was years ago, we've been together in everything. So we moved to LA together. We camped cross country. The clubs were born out of all that stuff we learned in New York.
Yeah.
And saw there was kind of a vacuum when we got here to LA. So we took those ideas and that kind of East Coast aesthetic. And we didn't see what we liked in Los Angeles. So we decided to start creating what we liked.
Right, because you guys, now, who's from Connecticut?
That's me.
You, and where are you from?
From the South.
Oh, from the South.
Yes.
Okay, so
yes.
A little further than Connecticut.
Yes, definitely. Yeah, I moved to New York right after art school, and he was still in school in New York. So we met there when we were really young, and we just, I don't know, we hit it off.
Yeah, so you guys came to New York, and that was right around the era of the end of Party Monster, The Limelight, Michael Alec, The Club Kids.
Yeah. Right. It was a little after that because this was when Giuliani was sort of shutting all the really good, fun gay clubs.
Right.
Down.
I was there when that was happening,
okay,
too.
So
yeah.
So then it was like there was, you know, we just sort of felt like it was time to go. You know
right.
what I mean? It was like it's not fun now. It's sort of oppressive and weird.
Yeah.
And we left and we're like, you know, where are we going to go? I was like, well, let's go camp across the country and just check out every city and we'll decide. And we kind of ended up in L.A.
We
and we liked
in L.A.
it.
And then just decided to move here.
And you guys, so tell me about the New York scene when you were there. Like, what was the, because you guys were both coming from Connecticut, from the South. You were getting hit by New York. What were the things that inspired you there?
Our experiences are different with that. You know, and I can only speak for myself because it was a couple years I was there before we actually met where my world just kind of absolutely exploded because I was coming kind of an oppressive suburban Connecticut town, you know,
right.
where I didn't even know myself at all. So the best decision I could have made was to move to New York because at that time, you know, you still had huge clubs with Kevin Aviance and Junior Vasquez.
Yes.
And, you know, the Tunnel was still happening. Michael Alec and the Club Kids were kind of still there, but not really. And then the East Village, which was my personal favorite, there was like a really serious rock and roll, gay bar type of vibe. And it was, you know, 7 nights a week.
Yeah.
And
what was your favorite bar in New York? The Cock?
I think the Boiler Room was
the
pretty
Boiler
fun.
Room.
The Boiler
yeah,
Room was
buddy.
A very horny place.
Boiler Room. Oh, you go always get laid
yes,
at the Boiler
could.
Room.
Yeah, you might find yourself there at about 3. You're like, damn, there's nowhere else. Let's get to the Boiler Room.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the one thing about the New York time frame is there's a lot more. There's a whole last hour to,
right.
to
yeah.
get that dick.
And then if you do get that dick from 3 to 4, you have to take them and do the deli light check. Did you ever do that?
Oh, no, tell me about the deli
you
light check.
You have to take it. There's a delis all over
oh,
New
right,
York.
Oh, right, yeah.
So you had to take them in the deli next door. It was really bright and make sure what you picked up was what you picked up. You
right,
know what
right
I mean?
Because sometimes those clubs are pretty dim, Lady Red, pretty dim.
You hold their hand, you walk them in. And then you turn around and you're like, oh, damn. That's your chance
really
to get out.
Right. So you guys met in New York. You had a great love affair. You picked up this freshman at NYU or wherever we were at.
Exactly.
You guys decided, because New York now, for y'all kids that just know New York as it is now, like, part of the, in the 90s and before, New York was a much different place. Porno theaters, after hours nightclubs, hooking on the corner. It was great. And then Giuliani came in and really started sweeping things away. I mean, there was a point there, and it might still exist, where you needed a license to dance at a club. I mean, that's some fucked up shit. And it really did start to, I was working in nightlife at the time, and it really made all that more difficult.
It did, it really did. So that, you know, that was our motivation to get out of there, you know? And at the time then, you worked in clubs some then.
Yeah, you know, I've kind of been working in clubs. I mean, I would go to clubs before I was legal, like even like teen clubs in the suburbs, like 14 and like, you know, you're going to a club tonight, you know, you're back
amazing.
By 11 or whatever. And as soon as I moved to New York, I started like, you know, dancing and cocktail waitering, just kind of always in nightlife.
And I used to work at a nightlife magazine, so that's how we met each
Which
other.
Which one?
Next Magazine.
Yeah!
Yeah, I was actually the art director for Next
you
for a long
were.
Time. A lot of people don't know this about us. We have daytime, you know, lives and
skills.
Degrees and skills.
Right.
That actually help us in what we do today,
oh,
you know?
Of course. You guys can't put on these huge events and organize and make flyers and make shows without some skills, honey.
Right. So that, you know, that's how we met because I was on the edge of nightlife. Of course, I went out to all the parties, but I wasn't working in clubs then. I was more writing about it.
Right.
And he was working in it. So
then now even talking about it, I think we had the natural fusion when we came together. It was like this marketing side and this mind of like publications and getting the word out in front of people. And then I think what I brought to the table was just kind of like, what's going on here? What's the heartbeat of this city? Let's create something like edgy and give people something that they don't even know they want yet, but they definitely do because it's not here and it's fierce, you know? It's amazing.
Well,
it's what I fell in love with in New York when I was young. Just like the nightlife was what, I don't know, made me feel alive.
Alive!
Alive!
Alive! Yes.
Well, you know, when we got here, nightlife in L.A. was not so alive.
I bet.
You know, it wasn't. And it's very different now. I think today in L.A. has some of the best nightlife in the world, in my opinion. A lot of people frown on that or they don't think that. But we've been everywhere and we know better.
Yes.
You know? But when we got here, it wasn't really like that. And that's what inspired us. We thought, well, what the hell? We were still working. We owned a magazine here, actually. And we said it ended after 9/11. It was really weird. And so we were like, well, let's do something fun that's different, that we're inspired. And so we came up with this concept to do a club and kind of take everything we loved and put it together in a night. And so that's what we did. It wasn't supposed to last. I mean, literally, we said we'll do it
for
a month.
We were like, let's do it for a little while the magazine's down. We'll find our footing. And then that club lasted 9 years.
Yeah.
Now, was that Miss Kitty's?
Yes.
Yes. Now, that was a legendary fucking club.
Yeah.
And the fun thing about that was that there was a Miss Kitty, a person,
right.
but she was your creation. You created her and dressed her.
We are in the business of creating monsters.
Yes.
That's what we do, including ourselves, to be honest.
Yes.
We created Miss Kitty, and like we kind of come to understand like all of our brands have like kind of like monstrous names, whether it be Miss Kitty's a character, Dragula's a character, Queen Kong, even Beardo Weirdo's like that, you know, kind of little bizarre cousin It type of thing.
Yeah. Totally, yeah. And so when you did, so Miss Kitty's, the idea was that it was sort of, you know, a postmodern whorehouse with a whorehouse madam, and you just called your friend up and was like, yo, Miss Kitty.
Well, she grew up in the same town that I did.
Oh, really?
So she moved with me to New York, and then she moved out here to L.A. with us. She was the receptionist at our magazine.
Amazing.
And she was just fantastic. I mean, she had this charisma, and I was like, you need to be on stage. I'm into this. I kind of see things in my friends, and I'm like, let's pull that out and celebrate it. Yeah. Like, that you're, you know, because people are like, oh, my God, your receptionist is crazy. She's, like, all colorful, and she's on the phone bitching people out, and I'm like, we need to put you on stage.
Yeah.
She was made for it. I mean, she was already the character. She just needed someone to say, here, put this on and put a light on this bitch and give her a microphone. And that's what we did, and she kind of ran with it, and people fell in love with her.
And we designed everything for that night. We did her costumes. I mean, the first show, when the curtains open, we were hiding on either side of the curtain telling her what to
say.
Yeah,
she was like, really? Hello, everybody. And I was like, welcome to Miss Kitty. Welcome to Miss Kitty. You know, and for a while it was kind of funny because people for years that party ran and we were behind the scenes and it was really theatrical. There were all kinds of little shows and vignettes sort of throughout the night, which is where we started to get our thing, you know, our feet wet with the idea of like dressing, and sometimes it was drag and sometimes it wasn't, or we'd be like old grannies in fat suits, or it would be Asian hookers every night.
We would be a different character,
right?
So, and multiple times, so we'd be like, you know, the curtains close, we'd go change and become whatever it might be. We might be like a lumberjack guy, or like he said, we might be in like a fat suit the next minute. So that's where we started doing drag, but we weren't drag characters. We weren't the Boulay brothers then.
Right.
We were just trying to hustle and make our club work, basically.
Yeah, which it did. But what's funny, because people would come up and be like, oh, yeah, you're that curtain guy. You're the one that opened the curtain for Kitty.
Oh,
and I'm
my
like,
God.
Yeah, bitch, this is actually my club, but we don't even have to talk about that right now.
Like, not only is this my club, but I dressed Kitty, and I told her what to say.
Well, that's inspired us with our characters. I'm like, no one will ever take credit for our work ever again. Mm. You can believe that. So any party we throw, you will say our name big as day across the
Yes,
top.
Honey, as it should be. Mm-hmm. Now, when did the sort of drag persona of the Boulay brothers start to develop?
Well, that happened with the Miss Kitty period.
She had to go out of town.
She had to go out of town permanently. Her father got really sick and was like going to pass away. And she really was like, you know, she was in her 20s, 30s at that point. She was just like, I don't know what to do. Like, what am I doing here? Like, I have to kind of go do this. This is one of those lifetime things you have to do. Yeah. And we were like, well, I don't know what the hell to do. So we kept trying to fly her back and forth. That obviously wasn't affordable really quickly.
Becomes very expensive.
Back and forth from the East
Coast. So then we said, well, you know, the whole club was built around a barker that would come out and get the crowd hyped up and announce the shows and stuff, like an old madam kind of character. So we're like, well, we have to do it. There's nobody else that can do it. Calprinia did it for a little while. Calprinia Adams filled in for her.
We love her too. Like, she's a, you know, kind of an OG friend of ours.
Yeah.
But it really kind of, the circumstance created the need for us to say, okay, bitch, we need to put on a wig, powder your face up, and get the fuck out there because someone's got to run this show.
Yeah.
And we tried to put the reins in other people's hands. It wasn't working. So we just put it in our own. And thank God. I mean, everything happens for a reason. I really truly believe that. So I think that was just destined to happen in the arc of our career. So, and then, you know, the evolution that took place very rapidly after that. Because I feel like the Boulay brothers in this form have really just a few years.
Two or three years. It was unique for LA to have, who are these two people together, look the same? And, you know, we were so crazy. We had so much experience because we had been creating this stuff for 9 years behind the scenes.
Yeah.
So it was very easy to come out and be like, I know exactly how to get these people to take their clothes off or go crazy.
Run this show.
Yeah.
People are like, God, like, who are these bitches? Where did they come from? Oh my God. And be like, we've been around, you just didn't know.
Right, I hired you before, but you don't remember.
I'm the curtain lady.
I'm the curtain lady. They give you your motherfucking check at the end of the night.
Yes. amazing. So that lasted 9 years.
Yes.
Yeah. And that was a club where at certain points you both were like, fuck this club. That's that crazy.
And you made them so much money
they couldn't tell you nothing.
They tried. Yes, they did. Well, you know, that club was like, we really mostly do clubs for our own amusement, to be honest with you. It's really not about the money. We want to have fun, and we want to feel like we're inspiring people. And, like, you know, we kind of decided, we're like, you make money, that's great. Money's great. Of course it is. But you have to like what you're doing. You know what I mean? And we're like, we like doing this. This is fun for us. We want to get these costumes and make people laugh and get them going crazy. I'm like, they're coming here on the weekend to spend it with us, to spend their money. They had a shitty week. They worked all week. They want to come out and be entertained. And I'm like, that's what we're going to do.
Exactly. You know, we take, I mean, in our drag, in our looks, in our life, we kind of live in the fantasy of our own creation. I mean, that's kind of what we do. It's like, you know, demons, it's Masters of the Universe, it's fucking Dungeons and Dragons, or like, you know, Marvel Comics or whatever. Like, these are the things that inspire us. And I think that we created these events so that people could get out of their lives and come and live in our fantasy, even if it's only for 4 or 5 hours, and just feel like they could do anything and be celebrated and, you know, applauded for it, which we do. We love that shit. We love when people just cut up and, you know, just let all that inhibition go and go crazy.
And that was kind of the inspiration for Dragula, is that you guys were like, we don't want to make a do a party just for money. Let's do a party that we really want to do.
Yeah.
And everybody told you, girl, don't do it. Don't do it.
I mean, literally everybody that we worked with, and I was like, we should never listen to anybody ever again. They were like, just do the
that's
opposite, horrible.
Especially this one particular friend of ours. I love. I'm not even gonna name a name, but I'll ask him. I'm like, what do you think about this idea? And he's like, I don't know, girl. I'm like, okay. I'm like, yes, definitely do it.
He does. He'll be like, he doesn't like it, let's do it. He's like, it'll work. But yeah, Dragula was basically a reaction to, it's a little controversial, but how safe drag and the gay scene has become, you know, especially with, and God bless it, like with RuPaul's blowing up the way it has, it's exposed drag in a whole different way now. And it sometimes feels a little too safe, and that's just not our style.
Sure.
So we said Dragula is going to be kind of the opposite. I'm like, if RuPaul flushed you, we will flaunt you.
That's the theme behind
Dragula. We're like, we want monster queens and, you know, gender benders and just the exact opposite of what's going on. And it's not against that, it's to go along with it. You know, it has to, you
we're
have to have
keep that torch burning.
Right.
Yeah. Because when I was growing up, I mean, it wasn't cute to be gay. It wasn't safe. I mean, drag was like, whatever.
The danger. Right. There was still a lot of danger.
It was very dangerous. Yeah. It was kind of dangerous. And it was kind of, like, it made a lot of people uncomfortable. And I love that. Like, I don't want that to go away.
Yeah.
So Dragula was kind of born out of those ashes. And We were literally thinking, like, okay, anyone's gonna come to this party? I don't know, but we're gonna do it up. All the shit we love, let's pour it into this concept. And people loved it. And then we took it to San Francisco. They loved it there. It was great in New York. We're bringing it to Austin for the International Drag Festival.
That's gonna be fun. I can't wait to go to that.
Well, because everybody's already in town, so the lineup is just getting
amazing.
Bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
Bible Girl, I think.
Bible Girl will be there.
Yeah, that's gonna be insane, because it's kind of like all of our Dragula covens coming together. So it's like New York, LA, San Francisco, all coming together in one room. It's gonna be
insane. The kids there are really looking forward to it too. Like, I know I've never been to Austin, and I've heard only good things about the scene there.
Oh yeah.
It's really edgy and kind of dark, and I think we're gonna find some baby sisters there that love what we're doing.
Oh, and I'm sure they're gonna be happy to suckle on mommy's double teats. Yes. The two double teats, the four teats of mommy. You guys are also working with Peaches Christ. You're gonna do Bear Barella here in LA.
Yeah.
We get like Peaches, we click really well with Peaches Christ and Heclina. They are two people that we sort of, you know, look to, you know. They're just very strong characters that we click with, because they both are self-made.
Yep.
And they've found their own niche and carved their own thing, and it's not easy and very difficult.
Yeah.
So it's good to actually be able to talk to people about who know what you can, who you're going, what you're going through, basically.
We can talk shop with them, and it's a small clique of girls that, you know, they're drag characters and they're performers, but they're kind of bosses in their own realm, and they produce, you know. Heclina owns her own club, and she ran successful clubs for 20 years.
So long, yeah.
Yeah, and Peaches is just, you know, her production, she's really well educated.
Professional girl.
You know, so we can sit around and just have grown conversations with them that we really value, love them.
Yeah.
You know, it's very difficult not only to throw events that go off, but to do drag and try to have a drag career while you're doing that is really hard.
Girl, it is so tiring. Yeah. Oh my God, I'm exhausted.
It is, and I'm relentless.
As I say. Yes.
I am relentless. You can ask him. I just don't turn it
she
off
really
ever.
Is.
So I'm like, we only live once. You're young. Do it. Do what you want to do now, you know?
That's just like you, Lady Red. Relentless, and you do what you want to do.
Yeah.
That's why we get along so well, son.
Now, tell me, like, Let's think about the young people watching. You guys have been able to achieve so much. As for someone who would like to be in the position that you're in the future, like, what are the important things for someone who's coming out to be a promoter or create an event and bring people together? What are some tips that you would give them?
Number one, and it's the foundation of our success, and it might even sound like a cliche, it is work. It is not glamour, it is not a cute wig, it is not contouring your lace front or having a lot of friends. It is a lot of focus and work.
Yeah. That part, the beautiful part, if you're lucky enough to be good at it, is 10% of it. The other 90%, you're gonna have an office job. Yeah. That's the way it is. You have to market yourself, you have to make deals. You can't give up. Everybody's gonna fuck you over. Everybody, from the people you hire to the clubs, yeah, to everybody in between, but you find some gems along the way and you strengthen your relationship with them and build on it. And that's what you do. You just can't give up. But also, if you're doing what you love, which is really what we do, it doesn't matter if you make it or not. That was the thing with Dracula. We didn't give a shit. If nobody comes, we're gonna have the best night ever. We picked a little ass bar to do it with no expectations. I'm like, they'll be happy if 50 people come.
Exactly.
Fuck it, we're gonna have a great time. And then
and
we were
did.
Like, why are there like, there's like a line around the block. We were completely shocked. And it was just, you know, people were just off the hook wild. So that's important. That would be my advice, is to make sure you're doing what you want to do.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, once again, life is short. You have one chance. Do everything you want to do. Why not? Why let things hold you back?
The
you
thing
know?
Is, like, we've always kind of noticed this. Well, we refer to it as kind of like this trickle down effect in the nightclub, because, you know, there's sort of tiers of responsibility, right? And we're at the, you know, we're usually at the top. It's our dollar. We're responsible for everybody and everything. The house wants the money. Everybody wants the money. The go-go dancers, the person that you hire for the door, all of it. If you are passionate about what you're putting out into the world, then the people right under you can feel that, and that kind of rubs off on them a bit. And then the people right under them start to feel it from them. And it kind of goes down, then right down to the crowd. And all of a sudden, like, wow, this party has so much life to it. It's giving me life, like, for real. You can feel the energy. And adversely, the same thing. If you're doing something that you're just not into, then that negativity kind of trickles right down, too. And it just doesn't feel good.
Yes, well, you guys certainly know how to do it. And the looks. Now, do you have somebody make all these looks?
Well, it's half of it we make. Sometimes, well, because we can't do everything.
Yes,
you know what I mean?
You're running events in multiple cities, darling. There might not be time to stitch.
Yes, I can't even stand shopping either. Oh, my God. So I'm fucked over any way you look at it. But
I make him go shopping anyways. But he does a lot of our hats. Sometimes we'll have them made, because we have a girl that we work with that is fabulous.
Yeah.
She made these for us, and he painted
them.
They're
so good.
We designed them, she fabricated them, I painted them.
Yes. Love it.
Thank you, y'all.
That's really gorgeous. I mean, you guys always serve an incredible look. You serve incredible parties.
Thank you.
If you're in LA, the Queen Kong is every Friday.
Yes.
Yep, downtown at Precinct.
At Precinct, the hottest new place in town.
Yes.
Dracula is going to be going all around the country still. You guys doing just a couple of those a year?
Well, Dracula is every month. It's the fourth Saturday here in Hollywood.
Okay.
But then we also take it, usually every two months, we'll take it somewhere else. We had been doing it San Francisco every month, other places, and I was like, we started Queen Kong, and I was like, I can't do this.
I can't do Queen Kong
on Friday night and wake up and fly the next day.
Oh,
I'm like,
girl.
No, that's not happening.
That's
I don't care how much you get paid, you know?
Yeah.
So then we kind of like, we just are taking Dracula on the road when we want to, when it's fun. Like every 2 or 3 months, we'll take it somewhere.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah. We have Seattle in our crosshairs.
Very nice.
Yeah, there's voices up there telling us,
come this way.
I love you.
There's a really gorgeous scene there. It's really raw. It's kind of filthy. There's like kind of like really hot built guys with like beards and full makeup and like high heels. And I love that. So I'm like, we have to bring
that gender fuckery. Like, we're all about it.
Mm.
Yes.
Did you say beards and full makeup?
Yes.
We saw her in the green room.
Putting on my man beat, Lady Red.
Not too much.
Well, Boulay Brothers, I love you. I love your style. I love
your
parties. And me and Lady Red are looking forward to coming and performing at Queen and Kong with you guys very soon.
Absolutely.
And darling, I wish I had 2 trophies, but y'all gonna have to share. You snatched a trophy on it. And I'm not sure whether you allow thirds in the relationship, but you will today. You want a lap dance!